Hi, everybody. So people often ask me why on earth I ever decided to be a professor. And this is usually less flattering when it's a student or a family member. But in general, my friends ask me why on earth I want to be a professor. And you know, there's the holidays, which, that's great. I get my summer vacations off. I get to come in late. That's always wonderful. But it really isn't those things. It's that every year, my students come to me and they tell me that my classes have forever changed the way they look at television or film. And knowing how to produce media, as well as how to critique media, means that they actually drive their friends and family absolutely insane whenever they sit down to watch the latest episode of Desperate Housewives or Downton Abbey or whatever, right? And my students both love and hate that part of their education. But more than anything else, what it does is it shows me that we really need to rethink the way that we conceptualize media. So the framework we always hear about is that media is one of two things. On the one hand, we've got the bottom up, or we often call grassroots media. And if you think about it, it's what our media landscape, it's what our mediascape can do for us. And this is where we've got documentary films online. It's where we've got open education, like TED Education, or the role of social media in the Middle East, those kinds of things. And on the other hand, we've got the top-down model. We've got the corporate production model. And that's what the mediascape is doing to us. So that would be controversies over privacy rules on Facebook, or those arcane iTunes user agreements that you just click on and not having any idea what they actually say. Or it could be the gamification of just about everything, right? From dating to, well, everything, right? So our own voices, our communities, somehow get lost in that top-down, bottom-up framework. This isn't because we're not there, though. Instead, it's because it's so hard anymore to separate the top-down from the bottom-up. So your local church or your local charity group no longer owns the images it posts on Instagram or on Facebook, right? And the images and identities of celebrities or brands saturate our world more than they ever have before. But at the same time, remember Justin Bieber, of all things, was discovered on YouTube. And your local food truck or your local farmer's market might depend on Facebook or might depend on Twitter to actually compete with the McDonald's down the road. So in many ways, I'd argue that the rise of digital tools in the classroom, in the home, and in the workplace, whether it's Photoshop to make fun of the latest celebrity scandal, or Reaper to make your own music and post it on SoundCloud, or After Effects to make a love note for your spouse, is actually where we find the voices that are shaping what looks a lot like a media revolution. And let me show you what I mean. So this is Elmo, but this is Elmo in a way that you might never have seen him before. Feel free to dance if you need to. You gotta love Elmo, right? Okay, so this might not seem revolutionary to you, but it's what we might call a video mashup or a culture jam. Many of you might be familiar with those terms. It's where elements from different media, in this case, we've got the Los Angeles-based LMFAO and the kids' band, the kids' program Sesame Street, are literally smashed together to create not only a new whole, but a whole set of conversations. And those conversations are about art. They're about our culture itself. They're about grassroots media. They're about what Lawrence Lessig talks about in terms of copyright law and intellectual property. This isn't just the same old way we used to think about culture and resistance. You know, that would be punk, that would be indie, that would be anarchist bakeries, you know, all those scary things that we're supposed to be afraid of. Instead, it's a constantly shifting and evolving counterculture. And this is actually part of the mediascape itself. In other words, it's part of the mainstream. So in many ways, this is like the internet's version of graffiti. And the story doesn't end there. Nothing is ever simple when you talk about digital culture. So while we've got Elmo, we've also got the original video for the LMFAO song. Yes, I know it starts with the Ron Jeremy. I work out when I walk in the spot. This is what I see. Everybody stops and is staring at me. I got passion in my pants and I ain't afraid to show it. Show it, show it, show it. I'm
sexy and I know it.
You're welcome.
I'm sexy and I know it.
Okay, so this isn't just any videos you can see, it's a commentary. It may be in the mainstream, but it's about masculinity, it's about sex, it's about fame, it's about the streets of Los Angeles. And despite the crazy hair and, let's just call them banana hammocks, shall we? It just happened to also get nominated for a Grammy and make their label millions and millions of dollars. But what does this all mean? Right? If this goes on MTV, why do we even care if it goes on YouTube? And what I'd argue is that this is a real shift. This is where the YouTube class or the creative class are actually interested in making new things even more than they are in watching old ones. So in other words, the logic of digital culture is really the logic of everything, right? It's that everything is up for grabs. It's that everything is source material. In other words, everything is actually a language. And moreover, it's a language that we own. It's a language that we create. And that we can change at will, and this is being integrated into the mainstream itself. So, technology, error. What's really interesting about this is that it means that we need to change the way we think about both the internet and our culture, right? Instead of a bunch of people vacantly watching Lost or vacantly watching Game of Thrones, we have an active audience that's looking for things and is eager to use the culture that surrounds us to make new products and to create a community interested in owning our digital world, not just living in it. So, well, on the one hand, we've got Michael Moore and Morgan Spurlock. We don't just watch those anymore. We might make Kony 2012, which, while controversial, really returned us to the idea of child soldiers. You know, we don't just appreciate the Beatles or Jay-Z. We might make DJ Danger Mouse's The Grey album, which is one of the most famous and most wonderful audio mashups of all time. And we don't just watch the news anymore. If this passes for news. And we don't even just watch news parodies anymore, like The Daily Show. What we do is we auto-tune the news, right? We share our disaffection with the failures of journalism, with the failures of media. And these aren't always perfect, and they aren't meant to be. But what's important is that they represent a shift in the way that media is made, the way that media is shared, the way that, for me, the way that media is taught. In other words, we don't just watch the media anymore. We actually live it. Thank you.